And of course, part of Config Manager was EPFI, so I went into the EPFI world. And for years, I went around Europe proactively, reactively once in a while as well, and to have a look at EPFI. In the beginning, EPFI 4, of course, later on, a large part around EPFI 5. And now I'm picking up a lot of MSIX, of course, lately. I moved into the Windows Virtual Desktop environment as well, do a lot of deployments there, and I also focus a bit on FSLogix and things like that. So during this session, of course, we'll be talking about moving over to MSIX, because we've been using EPFI for quite a while. 2006 was the acquisition of Softcerity, we got EPFI, and then the big milestone, I think, was EPFI 5, a complete rewrite of the product. It was a completely fresh from the ground, and we've been using that for quite a while. In 2015, we had EPFI 5.1 coming out, and in 2016, finally, a good integration of the EPFI client into the operating system, so it became part of Windows 10. And also for all the Windows 7 machines, came out the EPFI 5.1 Hotfix 4 release, and that really matured the client altogether. But that is, of course, EPFI, and it is time to move ahead. We already heard Tim mention it as well. Especially if you have a lot of packages, a lot of application, it is time to start looking at the next step for the application deployments and start thinking about taking your setup.exe, your MSIs, and your CLXones, and of course your EPFI packages, and move them all towards that new deployment technology, MSIX. MSIX is going to be the deployment methodology going forward, and so it's really time to start thinking about taking your applications and moving them away from EPFI and moving them over to MSIX. And the similarities are pretty large, as we already heard Tim say as well. We have the same kind of zlib library, zip file-like construction, where we got everything inside of the file itself. Just like EPFI, an MSIX package contains the complete payload of the application, so all of the files, a piece of the registry of the application. But also next to that, it has an installer like EPFI with the app manifest, the possibility to actually specify where we're going to store it, all the different entry points of the application. And we're going to make sure that we're going to assign an MSIX package, so it's going to be trusted, and that we can validate the code not only during adding the package, but if we want, also during the lifetime of the application, during every launch that we start the application. And we sign the EPIX bookmap, so we need to make sure that whatever certificate we're going to be using for that needs to be trusted on the device itself. So we've got tamper protection by signing all of that, and we've got the operating system that is going to be responsible for managing the installation of the application, the MSIX package in this case, also responsible for updating the package if there's a new version, and removing the package from the machine altogether. We shouldn't regret installing an MSIX package. Of course, I've been talking about EPFI package in that same way as well. At the moment that we are going to have an empty operating system just with running Windows, and we publish an EPFI file, we can then use the application, and if we then unpublish the application, we simply take all of it away. But we all know we do leave a little bit of remnant behind here and there, and with MSIX we really see we do a complete clean uninstall, and everything gets removed from that package at that very moment. So, when we have our EPFI packages, we can nicely start moving them over to the MSIX format. And it's included in the MSIX packaging tool that we can just use that to convert our packages over. And so, it's pretty straightforward to use a manual conversion. So, let me quickly switch over to my machine. And first of all, I need to have my packaging tool available, right? So I can actually go to the store and then search for the MSIX packaging tool. If my keyboard would like me, to type something. I can then find the MSIX packaging tool and I can simply install the packaging tool straight out of the store. And of course, if I don't have any internet connectivity, there's also the possibility from the store, from business, to get the offline installer and to get the packaging tool on my machine as well. Then, of course, I'm going to prepare my packaging machine just the way I would do with my sequencer machine. And so even if I want to convert, of course, later on, I might want to use the same machine to start packaging MSIX packages together. And so it's good to make it as quiet as possible. And disable that Windows Update service, disable that search service, and maybe even look for that defragmenter task that you have in your scheduled task and disable that just to make sure to get that machine as quiet as possible. Luckily, the MSIX packaging tool helps you with that. So it detects that Windows Update is still running, it detects that the search service would still be running, and it would propose disabling those services for you. I kind of like to have those launches on my desktop. And since now we're talking about a Mullen application, I would also like to have my Mullen application there. But looking in it from the start menu, I don't have the possibility there, of course, to get it straight onto my desktop because, hey, it is a Mullen application. But a way to work around it, if I really want this, is that I can actually go to my shells app folders. There I can, of course, find all of my Mullen applications. So if I then really want to have a shortcut to that Mullen application on my desktop, I can simply create one from here and it will just copy that for me on the desktop. So I have my tool installed. And one of the very first thing I could do is of course start sequencing and start packaging a package, because sequencing, of course, was the FV way of doing things. And now we are talking more about packaging, right? It needs a driver for that. And the moment that we install the packaging tool from the Microsoft Store, that doesn't actually include the driver. The driver is actually part of the operating system. And the moment that I'm actually going to launch the packaging tool and actually start packaging an application, it will check if the driver is installed. And if it's not installed, it will simply fire off a DISM command, install that driver for me, and I can go forward. And of course, when I'm packaging, waiting every time for the driver to be installed, well, if I could do without it, that would be nice. So of course, I could also manually prepare that by just going to my start menu, go to apps. So I have my apps and features. There I have the possibility to add an optional feature. And then by simply clicking the add feature, I can install the MSIX packaging tool driver on my machine. Awesome. So I've prepared my machine. I'm now ready to start converting. And there's a big difference of creating an MSIX package and it's an MSI or an executable, or the moment that's an FV file. And because for the FV file, it doesn't actually start monitoring. It won't actually dirty up the system with all these files. It will actually do a conversion of that package. So I'm going to start with that. And first of all, as I said earlier, we're going to sign our packages with a certificate, and we're also going to sign those converted FV packages then with a certificate. And so I made sure that I got myself a code signing certificate that could be based out of a third party. And so I could buy one online from VeriSign, DigiCert, and get a code signing certificate. I could request a code signing certificate from my company CA. And so all of the computers in my domain start trusting that package straight away because they have that root certificate on board already. And of course, I could also start using a self-signed certificate, but then I have to make sure to start distributing that certificate to all of the machines where I actually want to start testing my new MSIX package. So preparing here, I've got in my toolkit folder my signing certificates. So here I've got the certificate that I'm going to use for signing. And here I would have the certificate that I could distribute to other computers where I actually want to test these packages on. And one of the nice things about the MSIX packaging tool is that I can pre-configure a lot of the options that is going to be asked during the wizard. And so I can specify where per default my packages are going to be saved when I need to hit save. Or when I'm going to browse for a new installer, what location that is actually going to open up and offer to find me in an application to virtualize on. I can also decide that I don't want to virtualize a package on this machine, but even maybe use a remote machine or a Hyper-V machine based on this machine. Also, I can specify all of my stuff around the signing of my package. So I can specify the location of my signing certificate. I can pre-populate the password so I don't have to put that in all of the time. And I can also make sure that I can specify a timestamp server URL, and that the moment that my certificate expires, I still have the possibility to install and launch my application, and because I still have that timestamp in there. And so this is a nice way of preparing your machine so you don't have to make those choices every time during packaging. So a good way of setting things up. So I'm going to start off. I'm going to convert my first MV package, and I want to move that over towards MSIX. So I'm going to create one on this machine, and I'm going to specify what package I want to do. First, as I said, it's going to check my machine if it's all quiet. And of course, since I want to show this during demos, I never disable these servers, so you see that it pops up. And by default, it wants to disable the update service. It is checking if that packaging tool driver is installed. And if it's not, it will fire off that DISM command to actually install that driver. Per default, it will disable updates and then proposes to disable the other services as well that it finds in the background. So I can simply click the button to disable those selected services, and then I can proceed towards the next step. And then I have the possibility to select my installer. That would be an executable, that would be an MSI. And in this instance, of course, I'm going to select an MP file. So on my desktop, I have a folder containing a package called the myemployees.app. And I can actually open this up and start converting. Please remember that the deployment XML, the user XML sitting next to this, that's completely going to be ignored. So if you did any kind of modifications in there, added scripting to those, it will be ignored. If you included scripting inside of your MV package in your UpX manifest, per default, we don't have the functionality for scripting inside of MSIX. So we might not be able to get all of those apps working, but getting your apps converted is, of course, a very good step towards getting all of your applications over towards MSIX. So I'm going to open up my MV file. And as you can see, it detects that it was an MV file. It actually shows me that it sees that there's an MV file. It will only convert the packet straight into an MSIX packet and going forward. So all the defaults were already specified. So you can see that my certificate is there and the password for my certificate is present as well. And so I can just go for next. It will then harvest all of the information out of my MV file. So it will pre-populate my package name. And if that would have contained an underscore, I would have to replace that with a dash, for example, because it's not allowed to use underscores. I can then see the display name coming out of my MV package as well. And if I want to make any changes or make it even user-friendly, I can make some changes in this group. Per default, of course, MV was using reversed as the publisher display name. And now I can make sure that I can put my own display name in there. And then I have the possibility to set a version. Of course, I could follow any kind of versioning of the application that's sitting inside of this package. I could also decide that I'm going to start off my own versioning for the MSIX package. So I can simply start on a version 1 and take it forward from there. So then I'll click next. It will actually start preparing the package for me. It's all good to go. I chose a small brackets because it's a demo, of course. Let's keep things simple. And the moment that I'm going to click create, it's going to create my package, save it on that location that I specified in my example on the desktop, and I'm all good to go. And so as you can see, the package got converted and I'm good to go to start testing the application. So let me copy that quickly over to another machine to see if it would nicely work. And now I can simply double click my MSI X file. I've got that certificate already installed on my machine, so I trust the source, so I can actually click on the install button and I can leave the launch when ready, and just to make sure that I can see that the application is starting altogether. So application gets installed, everything is now added to the local cache. And of course that pops up in the other screen, but if I'll just drag it over, and you can see I have my application up and running, converted from EPI into the MSIX format. So a manual conversion of an EPI package is very straightforward, but just imagine that you are a big company and you've got hundreds of these, and then it's of course quite a lot of work to get all of these converted. And so quite a while ago, I wrote a blog post on how to start a batch conversion of all of your MSI files and your executables. And so I wrote a nice little write-up on that, specified all of the different steps. I used multiple machines to actually copy over all of those installers, and so we can actually record those installers and then get the resulting MSIX packages out of that. And that works really nice for EPI files. That should work as well. So, of course, after publishing, I got a nice email from my colleague Ryan Cobb asking, how about EPI? And because now you didn't do a right blog post on converting those MSI and the executables, but shouldn't we also talk about EPI? And I think he was so right. And so together we sat down and we started writing a blog on the batch conversion of an EPI file. And of course I published that out towards the blog as well. And of course I'm going to be using this scripting now. And so let's walk through that and take those steps to actually start converting those packages. So let me switch back to my machine. And now it's of course not a manual operation, but I'm going to take the time to actually do a batch conversion. And so first of all, I need EPI packages. So on my machine, I prepared a folder, copied over some small packages into there to convert. So I've got a bunch of EPI files. And as you can see, I left all of the other stuff behind. I don't need the MSI wrapper. I don't need the user config or the deployment config for this configuration. I'll just convert these. Of course, you could also just point your script towards your EPI content share and just harvest everything from there. It will simply ignore all of those files and will only pick up those EPI files that are sitting in there. So I've got my EPI packages ready. And then of course I need some additional stuff as well. And so I'm going to make sure that I have a certificate. And so in my folder, I have the signing certificate present, and so I can sign them in a batched manner. And now I should be good to go and to start. And so let's open up the script and that we published out. And let me start off by saying, I am not a PowerShell coder. I love PowerShell and I'm pretty good at copy and pasting stuff and borrowing stuff, but plain out of the box, I could improve a bit more. So of course, we could do a lot more around error handling. I should have made a function out of it and things like that. But it's an example script for you guys, so you can improve it and make it better. So I think that's a fair deal. So all the way in the top, I start specifying all of my different parameters that I'm going to need. And so I'm going to specify where all of my MP packages are stored, what is actually the publisher name that is coming from the certificate that I'm going to use for signing of the packages, and specify that friendly publishing name that we saw as well that we need to populate. I made sure that I'm using a counter as well, so I can actually add that counter number to the different jobs that I have, so it gets a nice little sequential look and feel, and specify the location of my certificates, and of course the most secret password that I need to actually start using that password. I want to have some logging along, so I'm starting a transcript towards the installation, towards the folder where the script is running from, and so in the end, all of the things that I see passing by in PowerShell and should also be available for me in this transcript. And then I need to start preparing for converting all of my packages. So first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to make sure that I'm going to make the templates that I need, the XML templates that I need to actually start converting the packages. And to make that work, I started with a default one that was kind of empty. Conversion. So I here have an MSIX packaging template. And that just simply holds the basics that I would need. And I can simply replace all of those variables with the scripts. And so as you can see, I've got an installer path between brackets. I've got a save location over here. And the name for the package that I'm going to create and the display name. And the publisher name that you saw being specified as a variable as well, and then the publisher display name as well. I keep all of them on version one. So now I have my basic template, which I can then use in PowerShell and start replacing those things between the brackets and between the values that I actually need. So as you can see, I'm actually taking that installer and I'm specifying that installer path, taking that save location, the publisher display name, and just creating all of those XMLs and getting ready to start the job to start converting all of those MP packages. And then I'm good to go. And so I'm going to save those XML files, as you can see, in the template folder. And then I'm actually going to start off firing off the MSIX packaging tool. I'm going to specify that I'm going to create a package, specify the template that I'm going to use to create the packet with, and actually went through that whole folder with the appv packages in it, with the get child item. And then for each appv file I found, I created that XML file, and I will then kick off that MSIX packaging tool. And just to make sure, I erased the counter by one to make sure that it gets all of them in the job, and I'm good to go. After this, I should end up with all working MSIX packages, or at least MSIX packages, working or not. This will convert all of them, and then I can later test if they will nicely work. And so I'm going to finish off by cleaning up the MSIX packaging tool, and this will now result in all of those MSIX packages being generated out of the MP files. But they're unsigned. And so then the next step that I need to do is make sure to take that certificate and sign all of those packages as well. And so that's the next step in my script. I'll simply go through that folder with all of the MSIX packages, and then I'll just fire off that signtool.exe, and then specify the certificate that I want to use to sign it with, and then the password that I want to sign the certificate with. Good to go. Stopping the transcript, so all of my logging gets finished, and this should result in all MP packages being transformed. So, as you can see, I'm in the MSIX batch conversion folder that we saw as the result. And so everything should end up, so that goes right. Previous run should end up in the MSIX packaging tool. And the templates will, of course, create all of the different templates. So, of course, since a batch was run, let's make sure that that's empty, and I'm good to go. I'm going to start off. And of course, depending on the size of the package, it might take a moment to get this converted. And so that's why I made sure to and select not the biggest one, and so we can actually see a nice result in this time. So I'm good to go. I'm going to start off my package script, and this should now start the conversion of all of those MV packages sitting in MV packages towards this batch conversion and mosaic packages. So as you can see, it starts that first template job. Then based on that template, it starts creating that first mosaics file. And then it starts with the next template. And then for each of the application that is located in that folder, it will simply create that template file, start the conversion process, and switch to the next job. And after all of these are done, when all of the packages have been converted from MV to mosaics, I'm simply going to go over all of these packages again, and I'm going to sign them. And so if I would look into the folder and look at the properties now, you would see they would not have a digital security tab. And so they're all on site now. If I would now try to install it, it would start complaining that they're not signed yet. So let's give this a little moment more. It's almost done, I would say. Gives me a moment for a bit of water. Nearly done, I would say. And when you test this, this takes 1.5 minutes, right? And when you do the demo, it just takes a little longer, but I'm okay. I have time. And of course, normally during a batch conversion, you're not looking at the screen, right? So it's okay that it takes a bit longer. Be aware though, that the moment you as a company start looking at this and you start decide to start converting hundreds of, maybe even 1,000 or something of MV packages, this will take a moment, right? So it might make sense to break that up into batches, so you could utilize multiple machines to get that done. But just having that run overnight would of course also bring you some results. And so of course we should be okay getting that all to work. Anything that's out of the ordinary, all of the issues that it is running into, things that it actually cannot convert, it is actually going to report about that. So that actually will end up in that log file. And there you will find that, oh, I found the context menu and yeah, we can't get that enabled. Or maybe this is using a piece of functionality and that is not supported at this moment. So obviously I'm all through the conversion of the packages. Now I'm firing off the signing of the packages. So I simply go through all of the files again. And if I would now right click the file and check the properties, I would see that they are nicely signed. I now have a digital signature tab. And there you can see that my certificate that's being used is present and I can find the information about that. And so all of my packages are now nicely signed and I get my first look at what the result is. And of course, if this would be 100 packages, I don't have the expectations that I can now take all of those 100 packages straight into production because it's a one-on-one match. As we heard earlier from Tim, there is functionality that's not there. So we even might need to fix some of those packages. But of course, doing this kind of batch conversion of all of your packages and give you at least those low-hanging fruits, that those packages that will work. So if you're going to take that 100 packages, you might end up with just 30, 90 working packages where you don't have to do anything more on. And then, as we saw, we can use the package support framework to get some additional packages working. And then, of course, we will always end up with some packages that might not meet our criteria to be able to take it in production. I think one of those examples that I often run into is 7-Zip. 7-Zip really easily converts over. I could packages, very easy. But the way that I would normally use 7-Zip is by a context menu. I don't normally start 7-Zip and open up a 7-Zip container. And normally I would just right click on that file and then use 7-Zip to open it. And so fair enough, I can get it fully converted and it will work and everything is there, but I am missing that context menu. And that's very often exactly the piece that the customer wants out of this. So often they'll stay behind in MV if they're using that until we get this kind of functionality over in MSIX as well. And so we can also get those kind of applications over. So as you can see, a batch conversion, pretty straightforward. These were just 11 packages, of course, a couple of minutes. Be aware, of course, the moment that you're running more enterprise applications, they will be larger, so it's going to take some more time, and they will be more plentiful. I've got a customer that got literally thousands of MV packages into their production environment. And that's why I think it's really time as well to start looking at this and to start making that move towards an MSIX. Especially in the full infrastructure environment, it is time to start thinking about the next thing for that. So the batch conversion, pretty straightforward. And the script is of course available online. And I saw already that some people made some improvements on my script and published some blogs on that. So of course, look around and pick the nicest one for you, of course. And as I said, of course, this will convert all of them to MV packages, to MSIX packages. But not all of them might be working. And so at that moment, it might be nice to start taking a look at that package support framework. Now, the package support framework will help me to fix that working directory. Per default, if we have a modern application, the working directory is the system 32 folder, and a lot of applications work are built around using a working directory. And so using the package support framework for these kind of applications really light those up. And then also, in MV, of course, we're pretty spoiled. And we have a lot of functionality there. For example, at the moment that I need to write to the install directory, we have the copy on write functionality in MV. It simply gets intercepted, that write. It gets redirected to the user profile, and the file gets stored there. And to get that kind of functionality with MSIX, we could also use the package support framework. We have then the possibility to enable that write to the directories and to have that redirection out of the container and making sure that that is actually going to be stored in the profile of the user. Another piece of functionality that the package support framework will bring along is the possibility that we can actually run some PowerShell scripts. Per default, we'll have the possibility to use a modification package. And so we'll have an MSIX package, and we can then create a modification package to modify some settings around it and to really make the look and feel the way we want it. But sometimes customers don't want to create a complete modification package for just changing one registry key or just setting a setting in a file. And at that moment, of course, it will be nice to use the PowerScale scripting functionality of the package support framework. And so during every launch of the application, and we can simply fire off some scripts to do that kind of modification for us if we need. And last but not least, the kind of functionality that gets added is the possibility that we have the possibility to launch an application with parameters. And per default, MSIX will just start the executable. But the moment that we actually have an application that needs to launch your application name.exe and then a parameter to connect to some kind of backend server. Of course, then the package support framework can help you with that, because we can then actually get that parameter inside of that and make sure that it actually launches like that. Package support frameworks, of course, available, documented on the MSIX docs page, so we can read up on that. The releases are all available on GitHub, and so we can get our information from there. So let's switch over to my machine again, and let's have a look at that. Because when I was using my good old FV package for the My Employee apps, I could actually write to my installation directory, and because I had the copy and write functionality, and so everything got nicely redirected to my profile. And so if I look at the FV location, well, if I also make sure that I type correctly, then of course in my local app data, I've got my Microsoft folder, I've got my FV folder, and in there I've got in the end the VFS folder containing everything around my packages. And then the package ID of my employees FV file was this top one. And then inside of there, I can nicely see that it actually wrote to a log file and is actually doing some writing the moment that the application launches. And so, of course, we know that the moment that we have our MSIX, we don't have this functionality, and so we don't get these files. And we can then use the package support framework to make that work. So the way that it is being documented is, of course, that we are going to then take our MSIX package, that we're going to expand that first to the local machine, inject the package support framework and the fixes in there, and then pack it back up as an MSIX file, sign it again, and I'm good to go. So, of course, scripting is your friend, and so I make sure that I've got some script for this as well. Again, I'm going to specify my certificate and its password, because I still need to sign my packets. Then I'm going to specify the name of the package that I want to start fixing. So in this example, it was that my employees app. I'm going to specify the location where the source package is stored. And so that's actually stored in that my employees folder. And we're then also going to specify how I'm going to name it, so I can later reuse this same name, but then in a different folder. Then I'm going to specify where I want to store the end result. So I'm going to specify a target and create a target file name. And then also I need to unpack it to a temporary location so I can actually inject that package support framework in there. And so I'm going to also specify an unpack location where I'm going to unpack it from. And I'm going to specify the location of the tool that I'm going to use to unpack it, which is the make upx executable, which comes out of the SDK. So let's start off. Let me put this to the side for a moment and execute this script. That's of course the very first thing to do. Just my luck, one of those demos not working. Let me quickly have a look at that. What did I do wrong? Same play, let's just try again. Maybe it was just bad luck. I don't know, just did this before. Maybe I changed the name of my package, fair enough. Ah, right, maybe I need to specify that it's an MSIX, fair. So, same player, shoots again, off we go. So first step was of course extracting everything to that unpacked folder directory. And so if I now check in the unpacked folder, I can actually see all of my packets being unpacked there. And so I can actually see the OpEx metadata folder, the assets folder, and the VFS, and of course all of those files normally included in the root, and nicely located here. Then of course I need to make sure to include my toolkit, so I can actually see that everything is running from here. And so I'm going to make sure that I'm going to put my package support framework in this location. And so that would mean that I'm going to go to my toolkit. Of course, I downloaded the package support framework earlier, and then I can select the files that I need. It's a 32-bit application, so I'm going to select the 32-bit variations and select the file directory fixup to change that working directory and the PFS launcher. I'm going to select that PFS run DLL, and I also select the PFS runtime DLL. As you can see, there's some other ones as well, and also the possibility to use that starting script wrapper. And so I'll copy that into my package. And then I need to make sure that I'm going to map my original launch that is specified in the OpEx manifest, and that it's actually going to launch that PFS launcher, and that is actually going to launch my application. And so this PFS launcher is going to behave something like a man in the middle, and it's going to be responsible for launching the actual applications. So to make that mapping, we're going to modify a config.json file. And here we're actually going to make that whole mapping in. And so as you can see, the moment that I'm opening that up, I can then specify the ID of my application. And that is, of course, what I'm going to take out of my OpEx manifest. So my AppX manifest contains that application ID, and here it states my employees. So I simply make that mapping and make sure that I use that same thing. And then I'm going to specify where the location is of the executable, of course, coming from that same location. So I can take that out of my AppX manifest and copy that path where it's running for and make sure that I'm going to use that inside of my config.json. I can then specify my working directory. And then also, since I want to make sure that this application can actually write to that log file, I'm also going to make a mapping for that file redirection fixup. And I'm going to make sure that whatever text file is going to be written to, that it's simply going to be written outside of that container. So I am honest, I am not very happy about having to modify this, and because you can see the amount of curly brackets and normal brackets, it's just waiting for me to make typos, and I'm really good at typos, so I tend to get a lot of these typos. So in the end, I get to fix this, I get this to work. But yeah, fair enough. Also, I tend to then go for that variation that we actually can simply go into the store, search for MSIX, which is really not my day today, because then I would have the possibility to simply install a PFS tooling, because it's there, right? So there it is. And so I could, when I was sequencing, of course, as Tim showed us early, I could launch this. It can actually write this config for me and do all of that kind of fixes. And so being a lazy engineer and not wanting to invent the wheel myself, of course, I use these kind of open source tooling as well to help me along to make sure that I don't make too many typos inside of these kind of files. So I'll save this file over and I'm good to go. Now I, of course, created the config.json. Now I need to make sure that I also get this mapping in here. And so, of course, here I'm going to make sure that I'm going to reference the correct executable. And so I'll actually go into my MPEG location, make sure that I copy the name, because as I just said, I make too many typos. So I tend to copy it over. I can then simply add that as the launch point. And now I can simply save this file and close it up again. And so I can save my manifest again. I now make the mapping. When the application launches, it starts the PFS launcher. PFS launcher is going to check the config.json, and the config.json is going to specify that it needs to launch the actual application and with the working directory and everything there. And so in the end, that should be the complete fix. And so I can switch to my scripts. That was the first part of unpacking. Now I can, of course, start packing it up again. And so it will be turned back into an MSIX package. And then the last step in the script is that it's actually going to sign it. And so I'll just hit enter again. I get a signed package again. And so if I then check the location where I was storing it, I will see that I now have a package which is nicely signed and sitting where I need it. So in the end, I'm going to get a signed up package, everything stored in the PFS folder. I now have that new package re-signed and with that fix in place. And so I could now copy that over to my machine again. Let's just simply paste it on my machine over here. Let's make sure that I uninstall the original one. There it goes. The other one that popped up, this one, was of course the MP variation. Let's copy over my package for a moment. And now of course I have the possibility to launch that converted application again, or to install that converted that V package again. And now with the package support framework included in it, my machine seems to go slower every minute. This presentation takes longer. It's okay, it's firing up again. The application will launch, and now I should have that right possibility as well. So if I now switch over to my local updata folder again, of course we're going to write it to a different location. So this is going to end up in the packages location. Then I've got my employees folder, and in there I've got a local cache folder. And then I'll just drill down to the location where this would have been stored. So then in my VFS, that didn't work, I would get a Contoso folder, and then that would actually show that log file being written to that location. And so everything then getting added to it, and we get the copy on write functionality like we see also in AppV, and we also have the possibility to make that work. And as you can see, a typo is so easy made. So even I specified that config file, even there I left a little error in, and so it still didn't do that file redirection. And so making sure that you have a nice little bit of tooling to help you along with that would be really nice. I would actually look forward to seeing something like a TM Edit X, for example. And I think it should also be time for Microsoft to make these kind of toolings, maybe. So that is the conversion of an AppV file, and the possibility to get that AppV file fixed with the package support framework. And then, of course, we can also turn that into an app attach file. And we can then also use that same kind of functionality to convert something to an app attach. App attach, of course, gives us the benefit that we can leave our Windows virtual desktop machine as pristine as possible. We don't have to install a lot of software on top of it, and we can simply attach the virtual hard drive that will contain the application with MSIX app attach, and then publish the application from that VHD to the different users. And so, of course, that makes it very easy and less necessary to start updating your operating system every time you have new versions of applications. Everything can nicely be done from the outside. So, of course, for this, also the possibility to use a script. And we have an application called the MSIX Manager, and that we can actually use from this. And you can download that, of course, from the internet as well, documented on docs.microsoft.com as well. And we can then use that to create a VHD out of an MSIX. In earlier days, we really had to do all of the steps differently. And I still have some customers that like to take this approach also for Windows Virtual Desktop, because it gives them the possibility to create one VHD and then add multiple MSIX packages to that one VHD. I think it is more maintainable the moment that you have your MSIX packages in their individual VHD files, and because the moment that you need to update, if you have all of them, you would have to break up your VHD again. And if just you have to update just one application out of that, and that would make life a lot easier. And so nowadays we can use the full string by specifying that we're going to unpack the application, specify what MSIX packages we're going to unpack and where we're actually going to save it. It will then apply the echoes from the program files directory onto that. It will create a VHD, and it's going to be a dynamic size VHD. So it's going to use whatever size it needs. So of course you could use some kind of default size. You also have the possibility to start calculating how large your EPV file or your MSIX file is. Add some extras on top of it, because it's of course a zipped container, and then use that as the size. Then I can specify that I want to save it as a VHD. Of course, since the new version, we could also have the possibility to save this as a SIM, and specify the root directory. The moment that I'm creating an appattach, per default, it will create a folder in the root of that VHD where it will actually put that file in. And so that's why we see that root directory being called out. And so I can simply fire off this script. It will actually of course, this will do the same thing in the background, but in the background, what will it do? It will create a VHD and make sure that it gets the correct size, create a partition on top of it, and format the drive using the NTFS partition, then create a root folder onto the drive, and then use, and then unpack the MSIX package to the folder. Apply the echoes to the folder, and then simply wrap that up as a file. And so I could simply kick this off. It will then start converting all of those MSIX packages and that you saw me create earlier out of the VHD, and I can then create those and use those MSIX packages to start testing, or even to take the next step and to start moving them over to Windows Virtual Desktop. I can then do that, of course, nicely in the interface. So I could open up the Windows Virtual Desktop nodes in the portal of Azure. I can then go to the host pool where I want to add my appattach package. I can then select, of course, the host pool where I want to edit it to. And then here we've got the option to actually add MSIX packages. And so I can simply click the MSIX packages. I then have the possibility to add a package. I'll just specify the path to the location of that MSIX package, and make sure that it's going to be stored on Azure Storage, of course, or maybe on some file share closer, or maybe some NetApp file storage. And then the application will be available in this list. And then I need to do one more step. I need to make sure to also add the application to the application group. And so I can then go to my application group and specify the application group I want this to be available for, and then tie that up to my application group. So as you can see, then I can go to applications. Per default, I would have my session desktop, and now I can simply add all of those MSIX appattach packages here as well. So the moment that I'm going to log into my Windows Virtual Desktop machines, these will be offered to me, and they will be available for me. And this will be on demand, so they won't be installed until the very moment that I will actually click the icon and it will actually launch the application. So that is, of course, a manual operation. Where am I? Let's minimize this one. Now, of course, we can also do that same kind of thing in a scripted manner. Of course, nicely documented online as well. I've added the link into the slide deck, so we'll make sure to share those links. And then we can simply use a batch publishing of the MSIX as well. And so we can specify what the subscription is that we want to use, what the location is of all of our packages, and specify the name of the host pool that we want to add it to, and the resource group that it's part of. And then here you see the application group being specified. And then I'm going to make sure that I'm going to do everything for all VHD. So I'll just do a get child item for all VHDs. And then for all of those MSIX app attached files, I'm going to make sure that I'm going to expand the Windows Virtual Desktop image towards that host pool. Then I'm going to add that MSIX package towards the host pool. And just to make sure to confirm that everything is in place, I can do a get. And then last but not least, I'll publish that application. So if I want to add it to the desktop, I can use this new AZ Windows Virtual Desktop application one. I also has the possibility to add it to a remote app group, and then I would simply fire off this command. So also that piece we can do in a batched way of picking things and make sure that after converting everything from an FV towards an MSIX, I can then go from MSIX towards MSIX app attached, and then use this script to make everything available in Windows Virtual Desktop. And I'm all done and I'm good to go to start testing of my packages, of course. And I noticed that I'm already running out of time, so I'll just leave it at this, I'll think. I want to thank you very much for your time and attention. And of course, any questions, feel free to ask and stay around for that feeding the bird sessions that we have later on. And so we can make sure to answer all of your questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Ingmar. Could you tell something about updating MSIX packages, process, concept, crucial steps, updating the MSIX package?
MSIX packages, you're going to take that same approach, right? So the moment that I get a new version of my application, the nice thing is the moment that I start my first version, it'll be nice to install it with silent install parameters. And because the moment that I do so, I will not only get an MSIX file, but I will also get an XML file. And as we saw in the batch conversion, we do a batch conversion or a PowerShell conversion referencing an XML file. So if I created that very first version, all of the choices that I made in the packaging process will be inside of that XML file. So whenever there's going to be a new version released of that software that I just packaged, I could just combine those two together, the new executable, the original package, and the XML that I need to start working. And then I can just fire off the PowerShell command to create that new MSIX package out of that installer. And since package name is going to stay the same, the hash value of the vendor is also the same, so the package family is related to version one. At the moment that I'm then going to offer that to the machine, the operating system is aware that it's a new version of that package. It will automatically, dynamically only pull over the differences because we want to be as optimized as possible. So every file will only exist once on your machine, updates it. If the application was in use, we will start pulling the files down and laying them down on your machine, and then wait for the user to close down the application, replace the version one, get the version two in place, and off we go again. Maybe a bit of a long answer, but...
Okay, thanks. I think that's it for the moment. Maybe others will come later on.
We're good for the feed bird session then.
Yep.
Excellent.
So thank Andreas now.